thank you for inviting back again. And I am Stephanie Plant. I'm a family of the local research coordinator for our youth research program. I primarily work with our observational studies, the studies that don't require any medication to be given. They're purely research, so looking to figure out the disease entirely. Does everybody know what lupus is? Kind of have an idea? Know somebody with lupus, but don't really know what it is? So there are several different kinds of lupus. So you can have systemic lupus, where essentially your body is attacking itself. It doesn't recognize itself as itself, but thinks it's a germ. So you can lose your hair, you can get rashes on your skin, you can pretty much be allergic to the blood, as it were, and have a lot of inflammation in your body, so your lungs get full of fluid around the outside, you can have to breathe, you can get fluid around your heart sac as well, so maybe it's hard for your blood to pump. Also some inflammation in your kidney, which makes it very difficult to process the waste products as you get out of your body, which can cause even more problems down the line. There's cutaneous lupus, which is strictly the skin, so people like Seal, the singer, has just cutaneous lupus. So it can be very severe like him, or just be a butterfly rash that some people get, just a little redness over their cheeks, sensitivity to the sun. And then we've also got people who get drug-induced lupus, so being in the hospital for a long time, being on all kinds of medicine, causes their body to shift, and then their body starts attacking themselves. One case that we had fairly recently is a young lady who's pregnant and has got neonatal lupus. So because her baby and the stress that that's putting on her body started attacking herself. And actually her baby is what was her second pregnancy. The first one, she had several blood clots, and it can cause even more susceptible to blood clots, but she actually lost the baby at 8 months. So there are several different kinds of lupus. I wasn't aware of that when I started working with lupus. Understanding that now and getting to know my patients, I can be kind of a better advocate for them and kind of understand what's going on. Because all too often people don't look sick. And when people don't look sick, sometimes we kind of like, I don't know what's going on, or they're just trying to get sympathy, or they don't want to do something, whatever it is. There are several celebrities who have lupus, like Tony Braxton, Nick Cannon, and one of the things I noticed a lot of her reality TV shows, she talks about the entire lot. Lots of our patients. A lot of fatigue, so being out in the sun fatigues them even more than, regularly being out in the sun. So just something to be mindful of, people who have, or if you feel like you're experiencing these symptoms yourself. It's very important to listen to your body, to be an advocate for yourself when you're in a doctor's office. You feel like your hair's coming out, your skin's a little sensitive, you feel really fatigued, your blood pressure's a little too high, you get a lot of swelling, a lot of pain in your joints, very similar to arthritis, let them know. There are tests that can be run. If you're a little suspicious, we do have a lupus research study that's specifically for people who were born in South Carolina, whose parents were born in South Carolina, whose grandparents were born in South Carolina. So technically, our research term, the research term, we are all Dulles here today. So what we do is we ask for members of our community to come in and allow us to take your blood, run you for a test on lupus, so we can compare you to our patients who need to know about lupus. So if you're concerned, that's a free radiation lab done. And those labs can be fairly expensive, I'm not going to lie. We ask a lot of questions about your family history. Do you have anybody in your family with other autoimmune diseases? So we think that lupus is inherited, but we're not really sure how yet. That's why we ask everybody to come in and give us a little blood. We've noticed that a lot of patients who have lupus, their family members might have rheumatoid arthritis, their children might have juvenile arthritis, maybe hypo or hyperthyroidism, which is a disease, a lot of the thyroid diseases are autoimmune, sarcoidosis, Sjogren's disease, all those things are also autoimmune and can be passed down through family. We also think that part of what's causing lupus in our community, especially, is the food that we're eating. So we noticed that bottlenose dolphins in the area are having a lot of issues with autoimmune problems. And what do we eat that stuff? We eat fish, shrimp, crab. I don't know if they eat crab. But in the same way that we get our water from our natural environment, we all have pumps or whatever, have wells, and we patronize our riverways like we should, and bounties out there, and just run lures. causing us to have more problems. So that's why we ask people to come on in. Let us know where you're getting your water from, where you're getting your fish from. Let's get some blood, let's get some urine, let's do some tests. You know, help us help each other. Because it's primarily an African American disease, primarily a woman's disease. Most of my patients are female and most of them are black. And some of them are 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 years old when they're diagnosed. And that can be a very scary diagnosis. There's no cure for lupus as it is right now, but there is one FDA-approved medication that was approved in the last couple of years. And we did the research at MUSC. We know that vitamin D is very important, that a lot of us are very deficient in vitamin D. One, because we're not outside. But two, because it might be something, genetic. We might have lower levels of vitamin D, period. And then we're not outside, so we're not getting any more. We're not supplementing our diet with vitamin D rich food. So I ask everybody, please volunteer to do my study. We do compensate $35 cash for your time. Takes about 45 minutes. I'll run through the questions quite quickly, because I've got them all memorized. I've been doing this for 3 years now, so I got them all memorized. We'll get your blood, and then you'll actually have access to the record. So whatever the blood tests show, you'll be able to look at it. If you go to MUSC for anything else, your other doctors will be able to see it as well. And that can be something very important for any other analysis for other diseases you might be worried about having. For people who know people who do have lupus, we do have treatment studies that allow them to try different medications at different doses. We do provide that medicine free of cost, and we also compensate them for their time, between $25 and $50 per visit. Because it can be a little time consuming. You got a car, you got to eat later on, that sort of thing. You might have to get a babysitter or stay a little extra at daycare, that sort of thing. So we really want to be able to help the people in the community, especially because they're being so sick to be affected by lupus. I will leave some information. I'll leave my card as well as an address. You can come up with it later. If you have any grants about dollars, you can give me a call. I mean, it doesn't need this money, but it's also helping other people as well. Does anybody have any questions about lupus, about research? Yes, ma'am. We think so. We do think that it's related to heavy metals that may be in the water supply. A lot of people say that because you get infusions, it's not necessarily chemotherapy. Lupus is autoimmune. Just like rheumatoid arthritis is, sarcoidosis, Sjogren's disease, thyroid disease, it's not cancer. It's not, a mass of cells that are growing uncontrollably. It's your body not recognizing itself. And I think people make the association with cancer because you do get infusions with medication. And it's very similar to chemotherapy, but it's definitely not cancer. I actually heard a doctor say that to a patient, and I was like, I'm sorry, sir, you are incorrect. How do you like that hydrogen?
Did you just talk briefly about the Africa connection?
Oh, yes, we also do a correlative study with the Dela community, with the community in Sierra Leone. I went last year in February, with Sierra Leone. And we went to a medical hospital there while they were doing all the other medical procedures. We drew blood from them there in Sierra Leone because genetically we should be fairly similar to each other. We do speak a very similar language. The Creole is very similar to Dela. I mean, so much so that I felt like I was at home. I really understood what they were saying. People walk up to me and start talking, and I'm like, wait a second, your accent's wrong. There you go. So what we do is we collect samples of women there. Women, because, we primarily female. Most of our patients and our control patients are women, and we compare them to those women there. We look at what they eat, where their water's coming from, we do soil samples, water samples, stuff like that. And that brings us to conclude, well, what is it that's different from us? We're not that dissimilar genetically. We're only a couple of generations separate from Sierra Leone. And some of those people actually left here and went back to Sierra Leone and founded Freetown, which is their capital, after slavery and after their emancipation. So we're really not that far genetically from them. But why is it that they don't get lupus at all? Like, these doctors know of lupus, but they've never seen it, ever. And to think how many people here, especially in the Low Country, have lupus. I mean, we have, in my studies alone, I want to say I have over 1,000 patients with lupus. And there are plenty of people who aren't in my studies, but I just can't be in every single clinic.
But to, I mean, that's a lot in just the Charleston area. I mean, you have patients who come from Texas, Alabama, you know, Boston, we have young men who came from Boston, they were running home to get treatment. But yeah, we do, we're looking at the genetics, because we need to know why are we predisposed? Why are women predisposed? Why are African American women predisposed when African women don't have this problem? Now, if it was sickle cell, that makes more sense. We understand that that's a trait that we can look for, but we don't have that right now with lupus. So we're trying to figure that out, make the testing a lot more easy, and so we can find these things before they become chronic and life-threatening. Because in the last 3 months, I've lost 3 patients, and they're all younger than I am. And the one of them had lupus and sickle cell, and for the life of her, could not stay out of the hospital. But she did everything she was supposed to do. Took her medicine, went to the doctor, but she went to the hospital. The only time she missed her appointment was when she was in the hospital. And she was still able to go to school online, was getting her nursing degree, and her body just couldn't take it anymore. So I urge you, if you have any concerns, please feel free to schedule an appointment. Like I said, it's about 45 minutes. And we can do testing for you. If you know anybody who already has lupus, you know, urge them to seek out new treatments. Because you can't get a new drug for them that's going to work unless you try. We're already out there trying new things. So we always have new drugs being tried, drugs that work in other diseases, and sometimes work in, you know, run across the gamut. So we try as many things as we can, as many things we think are going to help our patients. Any other questions?
Come on. My sister offered lupus to a person who grew up in the area, but it was so long before they finally decided that it was lupus.
Because the symptoms are so non-specific. It can be anything. You know, fatigue, and every disease causes fatigue.
You know, we look at her as like someone called body work and then a scar called therapy and not that. And that is, at some point, we say, well, there's something else that we need to give in that point. God, great mercy over the years. She's lived to see all the kids and all that power, but she still had lots of surgery and a whole lot of other issues that came about before this.
What about patients who are 22 and have had both their hips replaced because they've been on steroids so long that their bones are starting to degrade? You know, they had kidney transplants, they're on dialysis. I mean, it can be very severe, and especially when you're not able to get a diagnosis right away. So I definitely urge you to be an advocate for yourself or your family member and make sure that if you're not satisfied with that diagnosis, you get a second opinion, you don't get stuck with a medical student, you know, you do what you have to do to make sure.